first, this question that I also ask myself, how is music actually related to well-being and health? And I want to ask that question to you first. So I know you've been on your phones for months, but I would now still invite you to grab your phone, go to the menti.com website, and then fill out the code 23346, and then give a couple of words that to you, you could say, music can heal. What can music heal? What can music do for you in terms of well-being? And then we should be able to see the results coming in life if all of this works. This is one of the upsides of the whole COVID situation, that all of a sudden a lot of lecturers have become pretty apt in using all of these kinds of technologies. But we still have to see whether it works right now, of course. So I don't know if anyone has already... Is it working on your side? Do you see something? Yeah? Ah, there we go. Deal with emotions, forget about problems, celebrate joy. Feel good, remember things. With anxiety, negative emotions, depressions, understanding the world, feeling good, heartache. There we go. So the words that are large are the words that are often used by others, by multiple people. Loneliness, relax. COVID-19, maybe healed by music, I see. So maybe there are like people here who have a musical vaccine. Anxiety still remains the major word here. Heartache, broken hearts, dealing with emotions. So clearly that's a lot to do with love. Of course, many songs and music is about love. Lifting your mood, mood regulation, thinking. Of course, that's also important while you're studying, that you can use music to feel more focused and get into a flow. Dealing with sickness. Okay, but I think overall we can see that anxiety is kind of the prime mental health issue, you could say, that is linked with music, so that music can heal feelings of anxiety and stress and even depression. And this is also something that we'll see in the literature as well, in different ways. So I'm going to, you can still fill things out, but you won't be able to see this any longer. So we'll take a couple of steps back and then focus where the relationship between music and well-being and health actually comes from. And then you'll see that actually in history, in all kinds of different periods, but particularly, for instance, ancient history, Greek history, we see that music and healing are often linked together. So, for instance, here you see the god Apollo, who is playing his instrument. He was very good in playing music. He always won all the musically driven competitions. He was the god of archery, of music and dance, of truth and prophecy, and of healing and diseases, and sun and light and poetry and much more. But those were the things that he focused on. And we actually see this in many different historical, but also contemporary societies, Africa, South America, Asia, Native American music, shamanic healing, very much focused on music, where basically the idea is that sounds and vibrations, in terms of music then, are perceived as very powerful tools to heal people and maintaining a good kind of health. So you see that actually to such an extent that music, to speak in the terms of the historian Johan Huizinga, creates a magic circle in which people feel safe to experiment and playfully deal with all kinds of ideas and feelings that they may have. And this may be a reason why this has been related for such a long time. The pentatonic fifth scale that is so well known for heavy metal music in the past was actually seen as the devil's scale, that if you play that music, that the devil would come. So there he is. You often have devil, demon icons playing musical instruments to this date. Well, they are at the final. They were intending to play their final tour this year, Kiss, but he's also called the demon. So this relationship actually has been mixed. It's not only about healing, but also about this magical, apparently this magical properties of music. And where do these magical properties probably come from? Well, as sociologists, we would say that probably that has a lot to do with the importance of music in rituals. So that rituals bring together people, and in these rituals, people may feel bounded together, get a sense of a groupness, and that the music basically helps conduct these kind of feelings, and that's the reason why they have been linked for such a long time. So, for instance, here's an image from ancient Egypt. So if you would look at this distinction between magic and music and healing, you could actually say that magic, as seeing it as a medicine, is often perceived increasingly as an individual thing, that a magician, like a shaman, would heal an individual, and that at some point in time, the music kind of became separated from these rituals, whereas music became much more focused on creating these kind of group rituals, and were maybe increasingly separated from the magical or healing properties identifiable. So these days, we could say this has enlengthened to the fact that we now go see a psychologist or take pills as individuals to feel better, rather than to go to a musician to help deal with these kind of feelings. And if we look for kind of group solidarity or groupness, we go to a group conversation or a therapy session and such. So it's kind of disenchanted. The magic has sort of been ridded from the musician. And then, of course, the question is, but is this really the ancient past? And then you could say, well, actually not, because these rituals, the mosh pits of all kinds of even hip-hop concerts these days, church singing, being together, singing in unison, and of course the rave, going to dance parties, clubbing and such. It's not a thing of the past. Actually, these rituals still happen, but they've been ridded of their clear kind of ritualistic properties, that the idea that you go there to feel healed or something has kind of been removed from the idea, and that it's much more seen as something that you do for entertainment. But I think from the answers that you were giving, you could actually see that it's maybe much more than entertainment. And indeed, as the sociologist Emil Durkheim would say, if groups get together, then music can function as a way of bonding people together over something. And if this works out, if you have a successful ritual interaction, you could say, so for instance, on a festival when everyone moves their hands at the same time and everyone feels the beat on the same moment, you get this situation that sociologists call collective effervescence, kind of the ecstasy among people. The group becomes larger than the individual. And it also turns around, that individuals actually don't feel the group any longer, but can really feel themselves, because they are in the dark and the lights are flashing and then they feel bodies everywhere, but they don't feel like people are everywhere anymore. So both of these things can kind of be an aspect of this idea of collective effervescence. Of course, this can work in positive directions, but also in what you could say are negative directions. Two groups of football hooligans who are singing songs and then going into battle together is actually as ancient as war chants, for instance, which would also create a sense of collective effervescence among warriors, right? Well, brain scientists, people like Erik Scherder here or Oliver Sacks, would also also study these kind of interactions, but then, of course, on the individual level of the brain. And they actually found out that if people are in musical environments together, then they create more of this material called oxytocin, which is also known as the love hormone, which makes you more lovable of other people around you, having more open towards all kinds of interactions that you normally wouldn't be as open to. So actually finding evidence in the brain for the purpose of being in these kind of music-driven group rituals. And they, Oliver Sacks in particular, calls this neurogamy, that your nervous system lines up with other parts of your body and connects, for instance, your gut feelings, which is seen as the second brain in your body, with your actual brain. And that music can kind of conduct these kind of feelings. Now that we've reached the brain, we will also reach the individual. So we were now first in the group, but now we're kind of moving into the direction of the individual. And music for personal well-being is obviously one of the things that was on the top of your minds when you were answering the questions, because you were very much, you know, answering in the direction of personal issues that you may have. And indeed, neurologists, psychologists, ethnomusicologists, and sociologists have found all kinds of evidence for why music may be beneficial for personal well-being. So, for instance, memory retrieval. I remember that someone also said that in the answers. And even movement retrieval, so people who develop Parkinson's disease or Huntington's disease may, through music, regain some of the movements that they used to be able to do, or retrieve speech or memories, because the music helps them to trigger the memories that have been kind of clouded because of these diseases. So these are considered kind of the dynamic or propulsive properties of music that can trigger all kinds of responses in your body that you are not able to do anymore because of these kind of restrictions. And actually, this week, a video showed up in one of my live feeds somewhere, which was exactly this example. So I want to share that with you, which is a video by Marta Gonzalez, who was a former ballerina for the New York Ballet. She deceased last year, but in this video, she was suffering from Alzheimer's disease, and in this video, she has a headphone on, and they play Tchaikovsky's Swan Lake, and this triggers her this memory retrieval in her body, which makes her move again in the direction of the ballet recital. So it's beautiful, right? So this really shows that because she built up this memory of music in her actual muscles and in her movement, hearing the music, even though all her movements were limited due to Alzheimer's, all of a sudden she can make these movements again because the music triggers the memory retrieval. This is not something that just some neuroscientists say. This is something that has been now for decades already part of Alzheimer's, Parkinson's therapies throughout the world. So this is nothing that's supposedly new or something. A second aspect that is more novel is actually that scholars also at Erasmus MC here found out that if you play music during surgery, that it may not only help the surgeon in making the whole surgery more enjoyable, you could say, or more focused, or reaching the sense of flow, but actually that people who have surgery while music is played also regain their health much faster and often with less complications. And then you may wonder, yeah, how did they find this out? Well, they actually did a meta-review of these kind of studies, and their main conclusion was, I'll quote, music interventions provided during general anesthesia significantly decreased pain compared with that in control groups. So in surgeries where they wouldn't play music. Significance, that means in statistics that it's not coincidence, right? So that's important. The third aspect is, for instance, dealing with traumatic experiences, that increasingly it's normalized now that people who suffer from post-traumatic stress syndrome, for instance, soldiers who return from combat, that music may help them to create a new layer of memory retrieval from their youth, for instance, that kind of helps them deal with what they've gone through in these war zones. So these are all kind of more neurological, psychological explanations. Then I'll dive into the sociological ones, which is mainly focused on the work of the scholar Tia De Nora, who studies music from the perspective of a technology of the self, that music can help you regulate all kinds of things in your life. And I think this also resonates with you, because some of the answers I saw were very much about sort of using music as a mood regulator, you could say. So helping you study, right? So gaining kind of focus when you need focus. Actually, if you go on Spotify now, a lot of the playlists are created based on these kind of needs. So clearly people need these kind of playlists, and they want to click on like a focus mode if they study. And this also goes for energizing and, you know, regulating the amount of energy you have while you're running, for instance, or when you go to the gym. These playlists you can also find on Spotify. There's a lot of evidence on that the rhythm in particular of music can help you overcome all kinds of internal boundaries that you feel once you're like running a marathon or cycling somewhere. There's an example of someone who got wounded on top of a hill and had to descend there and felt like he couldn't descend because of the wound he had in his leg. But because he started hearing in his mind this kind of marching song, that helped him to walk down this hill. With grief, like use music to deal with emotions, with heartbreak and heartache, with giving a place to how you feel. Create sexual or romantic interactions, setting the mood. A scholar actually here at Erasmus University, Samira van Boheme, does research into how people create sex playlists, which even go from like the buildup of a sexual interaction to kind of the middle part where everything happens and then kind of the cool down period. And that sort of, it's completely sort of catered to the idea of what's going to happen, and that there are different kind of playlists for kind of more romantic encounters and a little bit more rough encounters, if you will. If these encounters are successful, like being pregnant, using music for giving babies more intellect, supposedly. There's been studies on, you know, having your baby listen to Mozart while already in the uterus, for instance. But there's also a research done into heartbeat music, that if babies are crying a lot, then it may help to help them, have them listen to lullabies that are placed on the beat of a heartbeat, and that in 94% of cases, these babies then tend to fall asleep. So you could say this is really about mood regulation, or kind of regulating your personal well-being. And of course, then we come also to questions of your internal feelings and how they relate to, you know, the lyrics of an artist, that you can relate to something that you also gone through. So I'll mention a couple of examples. Marco Bozzato with his daughter, Yada, and their song Samen voor Altijd. I came up with this example because in the television show 100 Dagen voor de Klas, which aired in the Netherlands a couple of months ago, there was this girl who was walking around in the school, and then at some point the interviewer asks, why are you listening? Like, why do you have your earbuds in all the time? And she says, I'm listening to music a lot because my father passed away, and I listen to Marco Borsato because it helps me deal with this. So, you know, just to let you know, to let you hear, this is that song.
Nooit alleen, je maakt me blij. Ik hou je vast en laat je vrij. En ik vertrouw erop dat jij nu echt wel weet. Maar stiekem kijk ik toch een beetje mee. Ik hoor bij jou, jij samen voor altijd.
All right. So, and she used this music clearly to kind of transcend a personal relationship with her father, but maybe also with other children of parents. Obviously, you have these kind of relationships, and that it means something for her, that she generates meaning through this song. Another example would be Steen, which is a relatively popular rap musician now in the Netherlands, who became particularly well known because she focused all of her music on her psychotic break she had when she was very young. She's still very young. I think she turned 20 yesterday. And she ended up in a psychiatric institute and started rapping about these songs. And in effect, a lot of people who deal with kind of mental health issues or feel that they're on the brink of these kind of issues listen to this music, and it makes them feel understood. It makes them feel like there's a companion somewhere that can understand these kind of feelings. So that's another example. And the final example, I thought I'm just going to let you hear something that works for me. And also maybe that really doesn't work for you, because I really like metal music. And one of the kinds of music that I listen to when I feel really down is very grim black metal. So you know, just to let you hear this example of something that I really listen to when I don't feel as good as I do right now. May not have noticed, but that was also in Dutch. So all the three songs are in Dutch, and you probably think I'm insane now. So that's the point of this talk, actually, because bringing all of this together, I came to this tentative distinction between what music can do for people based on all this literature, right? So on the left side, we have this idea of these internal benefits based on psychology, neurology, and such. It can have medicinal physical effects. It can improve intelligence, memory, skills, it can regulate moods, and it can create a sense of personal identity that you feel related to, that you have a sense of self. On the other side, we have these external benefits, so as a social conductor, that it creates a lifeline to the collective, to feelings of groupness, and then in extensions, feelings of solidarity, and then also social resilience, the feeling that you can deal with something as a group. And then leading to this idea of collective ecstasy or collective effervescence. And then I would locate something else in the middle, which I would call kind of transcendence between people, which can happen in both aspects. So listening to the music of Marco Bazzato, Estine, can create an imaginative relation, not only with the artist, but also with people who listen to this music. And you can talk about this together, and hence transcend any kind of boundaries you have between people. Why is this so important? Because a lot of mental health issues are also related to meaning issues, that people feel a sense of purposelessness or meaninglessness, and that one of the things that we've learned from a meaning-based therapies is that being able to regenerate feelings of meaningfulness can very much aid in dealing with these anxieties and these feelings of stress. So meaning is really crucial in making you feel better for a lot of people. And that is something that seems to be decreasing not only during COVID, but especially the last decade. And there's all kinds of reasons for that as well. But I've sketched a really beautiful picture of music. And as a colleague of mine always tells, walk into any conservatory and that picture immediately removes itself from your brain, because people hate each other there. So there must be something going on in music as well that doesn't that doesn't explain that everyone just gets along. So why music doesn't always bring people together? Well, of course, if we look at these different kind of interactions, we can definitely imagine that not everyone would be as excited to be in these different interactions, right? So just see the different rituals between the church singing, the marsh pit, or the dancing. Obviously, those cater to the needs of very different people. And you may actually also, because of where and how you grow up, feel a kind of disgust when people are standing still in a church or when they are dancing wildly and feel like that's not something for you, that actually works against your benefits. The same would also go for the music itself. That's, of course, another reason that I wanted to let you hear my favorite go-to music, because I kind of expect that some of you at least felt this need to walk out or to feel like this is ridiculous. Why would you listen to this? And maybe people would also have that with the music of Steen or the music of Marco Bezzato, right? So it doesn't work for everyone in the same way. So why is that then? Well, then you reach this sociological terrain that I'm so familiar with. We would say as sociologists that has a lot to do with this concept of social distinction. Because people don't only strive to reach a sense of unity all the time, but within that unity, they also tend to strive for a sense of distinction, right? So in any kind of friendship group, there's always a couple of people who try to have something that's slightly better or slightly cooler or nicer than the other person, because you want to, at the same time, be part of a group, but also want to be an individual. And at a sociological level and societal level, that, of course, develops very strong groups in which different kind of ideas about what is cool and what sounds good and what feels good come into being. So this happens in the socialization process as well. What for sociologists is known as sort of who are your parents, what kind of country did you grow up in, what kind of city, what kind of environment, what kind of school did you go to, etc. And they all matter in terms of what kind of taste you develop, if you develop a taste for music, for dancing, for these kind of feelings or not. And this is strongly related to things we encounter all the time in our work, class positions, status positions, gender differences, ethno-racial differences, national differences, even differences in sexuality, etc. We find these groups. A second reason is that not all people appreciate music. That's often news to people who do appreciate music, because you're like, how can you not like this? But in fact, all kinds of studies find that for most people, music is a secondary activity. So if people listen to music, they always do this while doing something else. And that there's a very small amount of people, 2%, who say that they sometimes only listen to music. That they sit down or stand and then just listen to the music. That's a very small amount of people. So you could say there's a very small amount of people in society who really focus on it in this way. That doesn't mean that people who do this in a secondary way like don't appreciate music, but it does say a lot about the difference between going to a museum and just standing there and just taking the painting into you. Not many people do that with music. Then second, there was a very recent study by a psychologist working at Utrecht University about sad music in particular. And they found out that over 70% of young people, when they hear sad music, it doesn't make them relate to any kind of sad feelings. So for instance, hearing the Marco Borsato song is not my taste, but I do feel saddened by it. Because I sort of feel sort of the emotion. But apparently for over 70% of people, hearing these kind of songs, it doesn't really do anything, like not negatively or not positively. So that also says a lot about who can benefit from music, at least in these more personal well-being kinds, right? In surgery, maybe everyone benefits, but maybe here, not so much. And then it becomes even more problematic, because if you like sad music, they found out, it can definitely often help. So it can help and alleviate feelings of sadness and depression, one of the main things mentioned just now in the Mentimeter. But it can also actually increase these feelings of sadness and intensify this. And they found out that particularly when people are also bullied or when they feel that they are very much in a social comparison, so on social media you compare yourself a lot with other people, if that has a negative impact on you, sad music doesn't really help. the kind of social context that you're in, so in where you were brought up, and your gender, that women tend to be a little bit more susceptible to becoming sad due to sad music than men. So they do say, and I quote here, that particularly after a negative life event, people may be more motivated to listen to sad music to cognitively cope with a new situation, to re-experience and work through emotions, and to distance themselves from past experiences. People listen to sad music as it is aesthetically pleasing, and when confronted with difficulties or a sad mood, it is expected to improve this mood, help cope, and provide comfort, while worsening the moods of others. So for these young people, self-chosen and self-identified happy music that has been shown to enhance the mood may be a healthier choice than sad music. So you don't always hear this idea that listening to a kind of music may actually be healthier for you, according to these psychologists. And this is actually something we already knew from the book and the film High Fidelity. I don't know if for those of you who read it or seen it, Rob Fleming, the main character, says this at a certain point: did I listen to pop music because I was miserable, or was I miserable because I listened to pop music? And as they tend to say, misery likes company, right? So it's not always like the evidence is, it goes in different directions. So here we are today, the COVID-19 situation with an empty stage, right? So we are lucky to be here right now. I'm told that I cannot perform in any way because then it becomes theater and that's not allowed. So I will keep this fully educational. So, of course, most people haven't gone to any concerts ever since, or maybe to the small-scale concerts. Of course, there have been instances when people did organize kind of rave events or such, but most people have been mainly doing this. If they appreciate live music, then most people have been listening to live music in this way, through the live stream. So here are a couple of well-known ones. So the one by Post Malone and friends who did a Nirvana cover set. Phoebe Bridgers got a lot of attention with her bedroom live streams. And here is a screenshot from the One World event by Lady Gaga. So lots of people went online instead. And then, of course, we started asking, and with we, I also say Femke van den Berg, who's sitting right there, my colleague. We started asking this question: can people actually also establish this sense of groupness through live streams? If they cannot meet physically together, is there a way that people can also establish these kind of feelings of being part of a group together, which seems pretty necessary because we need solidarity and social resilience to deal with an international pandemic. So it may actually be very helpful if music can create feelings of solidarity, because that will make it much easier. And then you had the famous balcony concert, for instance, which created kind of what we call a shared experience, that a lot of this music focused on creating a sense of being in the same boat together and going through the same situation at the same time. And indeed, in many of the initial responses, you see that people really appreciated that it gave a sense of groupness, at least for a little while. And you also saw that it created a shared discourse, right? So songs from The Police, like Don't Stand Too So Close to Me, all kinds of songs, they gained a new kind of meaning that in an often ironic way kind of tried to help people cope with the situation, to give it a new dictionary, you could say. And indeed, if you go on YouTube and look back on the comments from 7 months ago, you see a lot of these kind of comments of people say, thank you, as an ER physician dealing with the repercussions of this global tragedy, it is beautiful to have reminders why we are putting our lives at risk every day. You have touched my heart and given me and others strength to being what we are, doctors, because of what you are, artists. But it doesn't seem very durable. We actually see right now in an article that we wrote about this called The Lonely Raver, that people are increasingly just discussing that they cannot reach this sense of groupness, and that it maybe even makes them long more for the real thing, and that most comments in these chat boxes are about like looking forward to this. And of course, this makes a lot of sense, because usually at a concert, you get swept away by the music, by the sounds. You cannot have conversations anymore, and everyone is annoyed by the people who do. right? Because you don't want to talk. The sense of groupness is established because you're in that situation together and you feel the music together and you respond together. If you start talking with each other in these chats, obviously you cannot really reach this magic circle that we talked about before. It's just like a very slow applause. Oh, that's me? Maybe that's like a plug? Yeah? This is better, right? I don't know. Is it still working or...?
It's working, but this.
Okay.
I'm talking too long. The batteries are running out. And these things, of course, have been laying idle for months. Where was I? Yeah, you cannot share this because if you are in a group situation in a chat, then all of a sudden you... Am I echoing now? I don't know. I'll remove this. One moment. Like that. If you are in a group chat together, then you're talking and you're not really in that moment, obviously. And then maybe it makes you long for this even more. And this is what R and Femke's evidence is also pointing towards, that these live streams are just a kind of surrogate to the real thing, and sometimes a really bad surrogate to the real thing. And you increasingly see now that the live streams that are organized are not so much anymore to get this sense of groupness, but more to regain some income by artists. So for instance, the recent Billie Eilish live stream, which was very popular among a lot of people. I think the tickets were like 30 euros. You could see that it was much more about giving a performer a stage again and making people sort of listen and see that, rather than really creating this sense of groupness. Because I think after a couple of months, we now know that it doesn't work as well. So if we then return to our tentative distinction, then this is what we are left with, basically, that these internal benefits, they may still work. So if you listen to music personally, you can have this sense of personal identity, you can regulate your moods, you know, you can energize yourself in the morning and maybe make you relax in the evening. You can, you know, it can help you with memory retrieval, make you feel more intelligent, and probably the neurological, psychological benefits in terms of medicine also work, although maybe the physical effects recede a little bit, because I'm fairly convinced that being in a room which is really loud with music also has a visceral consequence for your body. So, and that's something that we're missing right now. And of course, the external benefits are really on a low level present right now. So I would say that most of these kind of feelings of collective effervescence are really difficult to reach. You also don't see other people have collective effervescence on television. Like, you don't even need to be somewhere to have these kind of feelings. Just looking at people having those feelings right now is impossible, because nowhere can people congregate. But the one thing that I focused on initially is, of course, this idea of transcendence between people, that music can generate meaning between people. And I would say that this is what we should, if I give you any kind of advice, this is what music in your personal well-being questions should maybe focus upon. How can you amplify feelings of transcendence right now, this between people, that generates a sense of meaning that makes you resonate more with your environment and with the people around you? And I think the word resonance is really important in this regard, because it focuses on this idea that you give something, you get something back in return, which can create a sense of togetherness, even on the level of just two people, and they don't even need to be in the same room. So based on this, I promised you that I would share three tips or life hacks. So the guarantee will be until the door, right, as they say. So, you know, do whatever works for you. But I think I think these things may be helpful if you haven't been doing it already. So the first thing I would say is try, within all these regulations, to kickstart music-driven rituals. So try to make them ritualistic, right? Just don't just listen to music, but try to organize a party for yourself. Even among your household, try to, you know, start dancing if you're into dancing, but make it focused upon something. listening to an entire album, watching a live stream together. Make it more ritualistic than just consuming something and not reflecting on it, or like making your body respond to it. The second one is one of my personal favorites, is that I would always suggest that you return to old school recommendation systems. So don't rely on the algorithms of YouTube and Spotify, which are robots telling you, you know, what to listen to. They can be mega useful, of course. But right now, you could actually focus on your friends. What are they listening to? Make themed mixtapes or playlists. Organize online listening parties. Because one of the issues that I often identify with, especially young people in a time of digital media, is that when a new album or song comes out, then they say, yeah, I shared it with all my friends. Which is, of course, nice. You can now immediately listen to that music. But in the past, and I'm not saying that everything was better in the past, but one of the things that maybe was better in the past is that you would usually, in a group of friends, only have one person who was able to buy a new record. And then you would go to their house, listen to the record together, and then talk about it, right, in ideal situations. I highly recommend doing these kind of things, like reflect on the music, and actually also use music to ask how your friends and families are doing. Like, what kind of music have you been listening to? And then don't end there and say, can you send me the links? I'll listen to it. But ask them, why have you been listening to that? What do these songs mean for you? Like, why are you listening to these kind of sad songs, for instance, or these happy songs? What could I learn, you know, from these songs? What could the songs do for me? And I think this is very meaning generating, and it's also fun. And then third, make music as much as you can. So start playing a new instrument or an instrument if you don't already do so. Get some tools to make recordings and work together on songs online. So actually it's relatively cheap these days to make relatively high quality recordings at home. Like an interface costs about 80 to 100 euros if you have a decent one. Microphones, a lot of things aren't as expensive anymore. You can work together online, try to make music. You can create audio software where you can make your own beats and such. But try again to focus this not on just making it yourself, which may also be helpful because, you know, you can share your feelings and such. But a problem with making music and not being so good at it is that you cannot immediately, you know, share these feelings in your music because you first have to learn how to do it. And then it really helps if you do it together. Then you make it fun. You include kind of these ritual aspects. Open the magic circle. So make it playful. There's a reason that we say that you play music, right? It's playing. It's not something beyond that, actually. It's the idea that you open this magic circle and are playful in listening to it and making it. So set small music-driven goals, like make a fun concept album together. I don't know, try to be creative and do what you think is fun and enjoyable and meaning-generating. And then, of course, these life hacks can also be applied post-COVID. That's a nice thing. And we'll get there someday, I hope. So that's it. Thank you very much. Are there questions? I can't really see, so you need to help me. I only see light. Oh, I see some faces here, but no questions. Are there questions on YouTube? Yeah.
So, do you think that a musical preference somehow is more neurologically determined or more culturally determined?
Good question. So the question was, is musical preference or taste more neurologically determined? So basically, are you born with a certain kind of taste, or is it more socially determined? I would say it's what we call nurture, probably. It's a combination of both. But having done a lot of work specifically in the social sciences, I would say it's more nurture than nature. There's probably some aspects that you're born into, but for instance, the fact that most people in Western societies appreciate the same kind of music, and that in different continents we see very different kinds of music, you could kind of assume that it's less nature and more nurture in the kind of society that you grow up in, right? But of course, we have these rules of universality, that different kinds of music and rhythms have been developed at the same time in history in different locations where they didn't speak to each other or couldn't have contact with each other. So there's a lot of evidence about that as well, which would maybe say that at least some aspects of music seem to be universally shared. So for instance, a sense of rhythm and a sense of melody seem to be universally developed things across the world and without communicating with each other. The social aspects are, of course, in most cases, crucial. So the music that your parents listen to, even whether your parents listen to music in your house, can be detrimental to whether you start to appreciate music later in life. But there's, of course, always this case of a family with 10 kids, 9 kids don't listen to music because their parents don't, and then there's the one kid who's a musical genius, right? There's movies about these kind of characters. And so that always... You should always have some space for these kind of unique natural explanations, which we cannot really know about where they really come from. But I would always say it's an interaction. Yeah.
So there was a part where you said that probably if you're into sad music, for example, and you start listening to it, it might have some effect on you that.
Yeah.
But isn't the idea that something is sad just created in our mind? So, just for example, the song by Michael Bassano isn't sad. It might actually be a happy song about being together forever.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
But maybe the tones are bringing you in a sad mood or something. So, how do you define then what is sad or what is happy and what is better for you in a certain mood?
Yeah, right. Very good question for people online. I won't repeat everything, but the main point was how can we define this idea of sadness, particularly in sad songs? Actually, I don't think any studies have tried to figure this out. I think most studies will rely on this idea of self-reporting, that in this survey, for instance, that was done by Tom ter Bocht and colleagues in Utrecht. They relied on people identifying themselves whether they found a song sad or not, and they selected songs that are generally, by most people, are identified as sad songs. But the question then was, do the songs make you sad? You could argue, indeed, that those songs were, in fact, not sad songs, right? That they could carry another kind of meaning, because obviously that is contextual. Like Marco Borsato's songs, like a song, I don't know exactly all the lyrics, but I know that it's about parent-child relationships, and that probably if you in some way are fairly emotional about that yourself with your own children or with your parents, then probably it will be more of a sad song when you have really a poor relationship with your parents or something, and that song like that doesn't resonate. But that's kind of difficult to define indeed. But the point, I think, from the study, which I found so interesting, is that there are a lot of people who basically don't get any kind of sad or like positive or negative reaction from this kind of music, and that it's just music to them. And that's often, for people who really appreciate music, it's often puzzling. I'm sure some of you have been in these kind of situations where you hear a song and you're kind of swept away in your mind by this song, and then someone starts talking, and then you feel, how can you start like saying something about dinner or whatever while this song is playing, like I'm completely in it. And then you notice kind of these differences that people don't, like they didn't fall in the same kind of magic cauldron or something. But it's a good point. It's very context dependent. It's probably also very much dependent on nationalities and the differences of how you express emotions. For instance, in classical music, being very actively sad or emotional is often by the more snobistic type seen as problematic, right? That you should be more detached in your music and that it shouldn't be very clearly emotional, because that's kind of lowbrow and that's kind of popular culture and that's seen as a problem. So there's all kinds of differences there, of course. Well, I think one of the points made in the article, in which was also a reason for me that it captured my interest, is that I always read these sayings like "music saved my life," and Tower Records famously used this "no music, no life" slogan, which really, to me, fuels the idea that music can do this for you, right? That music in some way can save this for you, make you feel better. But then on the other hand, there's also evidence that music can make you feel worse. So a lot of studies in the past, most studies in the past that were done on popular music genres and depression and mental health were about negative aspects. So that, for instance, if you listen to country music or heavy metal music, that you were more prone to be depressed or to commit suicide. And a lot of studies were about that. And only increasingly now they're doing studies about how it can also maybe help you in ways, but I think this study really shows that it can be both, and that it's not very clear when it can be both. That for some people it can be negative, for some people it can be positive, and maybe for some people it can be both. And I don't know about you, but I also had moments in my life that I thought, oh, I feel sad, I'm going to listen to sad music, and it got worse. And it's like, no, I shouldn't do this. Like, this is a bad idea. And at other times it really does work. Like, it really makes you feel better in a way. So that's also personal again. Yeah. Well, there was also a question behind him. You're in charge.
One of the online questions is, how can you treat like a certain song can trigger the certain emotion? Like, for
So the last question, like, can music cope with a sad event? I suppose that's kind of what we were talking about. Transport. Yeah, like I said, I mean, I'm treading on thin ice here because I'm not a neurologist. So I do know that this that socialization and when you listen to this music matters greatly for how it affects the memory retrieval at later life, for instance. So most people develop a taste in music in their young adolescence. So people, all kind of studies show that people are most prone to new kinds of music when they're between 10 and 30, sort of in their 20s, right? Young adolescents, this is also when people join like subcultural groups, when they really develop these kind of tastes. And this is also why you see that people, when they age, they don't tend to go to new kind of, a lot of people don't tend to go to new kind of artists and such, but they go to decade parties. Like the 30 year somethings of right now, they prefer, most of them prefer to go to like Foutefeste or 90s decade parties, because that was the music of their time when they were in this moment. And according to these neurologists, they would say that the music that basically the music sticks in your brain better in this particular era. So the love songs that you heard when you were growing up and that became kind of attached to your earliest love situations are probably also the ones that will be most easy to recall when you're very old, right? So that kind of creates pathways in your brain of associations between songs or music and memory retrieval. And this is also how it works with Parkinson's and Huntington's and all these diseases, where usually they are able to make people move a little bit again by using lullabies, so children's songs, because those are the songs that people kind of universally know and that they grew up on, right? So that makes the argument that it's very much about what you hear in your youth, and it also really drives home the point that it's recommendable that children listen to music from a young age onwards, probably. But again, like, I'm not a neurologist, so this is just what I read from neurologists. Yeah. So do these findings differ for musicians and non-musicians? I don't think so. I think that probably every musician also listens to music. So at least that relates them. But of course, people who just listen to music are not necessarily musicians. So they probably don't develop the same kind of motor maps that musicians do. So one thing that they find in these studies about Alzheimer's or memory retrieval, for instance, is that people who learned an instrument from a young age, that they're able, when they cannot do anything else anymore, that they are able to start playing music that they learned when they were younger and then finish that. So there's one story of a guy who, this is in the Oliver Sacks book, a guy who for some kind of reason got a very short-term memory of about a couple of seconds. So every couple of seconds, his kind of life starts again. But he used to be a composer of classical music. And then the one way to regain a longer sense of consciousness is if they put him in front of a piano and he plays. And then he can actually also have conversations. And once the music stops, he cannot have the conversations any longer. Sort of that opens up a pathway into a conscious that he cannot enter anymore before. And that probably is related to having a relationship between your motor skills and the music in your head. And of course, he's a composer, so that means that you're in music all day, and you're doing this all day. So this probably works differently regarding what kind of instrument you play, what kind of music you play, and such. It will probably be different for like a DJ, I suppose. But there's really few studies that try to empirically understand this. Yeah.
Have you ever imagined yourself being deeply invented and putting death metal on the bed bones, when I'm 5 years old, and you become lively again?
Have I imagined myself becoming lively after? Yes, yeah, for sure. Yeah, but I mean, that's also why I'm often reluctant to share personal examples, but I thought you're maybe also here to, you know, get a sense of unity among each other of people who like music. So I thought let's share something personal today. But definitely, yeah, I feel with hearing this kind of music, I feel like invigorated. I feel very alive. And with death metal in particular, this was black metal. So black metal kind of, to me, creates like a crack in the earth and makes you feel like all the darkness, which is nice. Like you can kind of look in the black hole and then peer into it and then feel kind of okay that you're still, you know, here. And death metal is more like energetic, I suppose. So if I would hear death metal when I'm 105, I think if it was the death metal that I grew up on, yeah, for sure, I'll be rocking in my whatever chair I'll be sitting in, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, Gabber as well, yeah, I'm sure. Yeah, I know that the person who does these studies, I forgot his first name, Jekyll, who does the studies on surgery in Erasmus MC, we actually had this conversation once about this because he said, no, it's just with, it should really be classical music and positive music. And I said, no, I'm really convinced that if you put me on a surgery table and you play death metal bands, that I'll recover faster. But, you know, you have to do these kind of studies in with control groups and such, and I wasn't ready to submit to that yet. Yeah. So can music, what you hear in music, can it influence our perception of others? Yeah, Yes, for sure. I think so. Like music also conveys information. It doesn't. It conveys a lot of things, and we've mainly been talking about feelings and also kind of implicit feelings of groupness, right? Knowing that people are around you, but it often, of course, also contains a story. Like a lot of, particularly like punk music and such, and contemporary hip hop. Just think about Black Lives Matter, for instance. Hip hop is a vehicle of getting these stories out there to a susceptible audience who wants to hear these stories as told through this music. So it can definitely tell this, and it can then also, if it can do that, it can also tell stories about how you should deal with feelings. And I think actually thinking about such genres, you find evidence all over the place that probably in a lot of death metal, that's the fun thing about metal. Like you don't have to hear the lyrics because you often can't understand it. So I have no clue what they're singing, which I like, because for me it's much more the music than the vocals. But that music is often about feeling powerful and feeling strong and like this kind of masculinity, which I actually don't like at all. But it's like, but that's what the music can convey. And other kinds of music, particularly for instance like singer-songwriter stuff, is often much more about being vulnerable, about dealing with it by talking about your feelings and by being open about it. And I suppose like most death metal songs don't really cater to these kind of needs. There probably must be metal bands now that actually do this, I think, but not many. So definitely it matters. Yeah, but I think a final thing about that is that a lot of people don't care about lyrics either. And that can go in both directions. So they can either listen to music and they don't really hear what they're saying, or they don't really focus on what it could mean for them. So one, I'm trying to find a good example. So for instance, in the 80s, you had this kind of a couple of cases where people committed suicide because they listened to bands like Judas Priest and Ozzy Osbourne. And that actually caused the PMRC, the Parents Music Resource Center, to have lawsuits and to create those labels, parental advisory, those stickers on albums, that you shouldn't listen to that maybe. And that also hinged very much on the idea that people listen to that and that they take that word for word as a message that you should listen to. But of course, millions of people don't. Like millions of people shout along with those lyrics and they say, yeah, sure. Even if they would say that to kill yourself, you're not going to do that because like that's not the point. So again, there's lots of differences there. So yeah, how does the technology has an influence on how we experience music? Well, I think it's definitely dependent on the kind of situation you have at your house, right? So if you have a really top-notch audio system and with subwoofers and everything, and you kind of mimic the situation you have in a concert venue, and you don't have neighbors, then maybe it's much better than if you just listen on a rusty headphone that only has half of it working and all the bass fell out for some reason. So that matters. Technologically, like if you focus on where the music comes from, we do see a lot of evidence that that people listen differently to music these days than they did in the past. So now, actually, songwriters focus very much on the initial 30 seconds of a song because they know that if the first 30 seconds of a song are good, then people aren't going to skip through them in Spotify. And if you don't skip through them, then you stay on playlists longer, because if the skip rate, as they call it, is too high, you will be removed from playlists. But also you get paid. It's not much. But if they skip the song before 30 seconds, you don't get streaming money. And also platforms like TikTok are catered actually to these 30 seconds, you could say, that they really focus on that musicians increasingly focus on making songs that work well with TikTok. And TikTok can make you famous, right? So Old Town Road, the hit of last year, was a TikTok hit initially. So musicians think about this, and this also, of course, affects then how we listen to music. You also don't see many concept albums anymore because it's just single after single after single these days. Yeah.
You said that sometimes we hear sad music to
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good point. So if can we extend this idea of whether sad music is good for you or bad for you to songwriting, and that sad songwriters also tend to end up in sad ways, so to say. Indeed, that's a really difficult question. Like, I mean, you can answer that from so many perspectives, and I think all of them would be right in some way. And I think what I could say about that is in those studies that they find about sad music, that the auxiliary things that are going on in people's lives, so I showed you that people who are suffering from sort of issues of social comparison, that they are basically on social media too much and too much focusing on what other people look like and what other people have in their house and what other people do in their lives, that then apparently for those people, it's a little bit more tricky or dangerous to listen to sad music. Maybe that also extends to making it, right? That, and you can even imagine if you go on, and I'm freely theorizing here, right? So again, this is also just an opportunity to think about these things, is that you could assume that if people are very prone to doing these kind of comparisons and they want to make sad music and that they want to share the sad music, because usually you make music, not everyone, but a lot of people make music to have it heard by others, then maybe you run the risk of really being very unkind to what you make yourself, and that actually could make you feel sad, right? That you feel like you don't want to share it because it's not good enough or it doesn't. So I can imagine that if you don't feel kind of the sense of security about it, that it may actually be better to make maybe happier music then. But again, this, if we start, like psychologists and sociologists, they do tend to focus on kind of what happens in groups. This survey research focuses on what happens in groups. And if we really start fleshing out these kind of individual cases, then often it becomes a little bit tricky on to say like what is good or what is bad. So always, you know, keep that in mind. Yeah. Reinvigorated. Yeah, very good question. So the question was that briefly that in the pandemic there seems to be a lot of attention to gaining physical health or maintaining physical health, also with COVID in mind, right? That there's all kinds of evidence that if you're physically in a relatively good health, that you run less of a risk of being very sick by COVID. And indeed, that maybe in politics they should focus more on these well-being effects of music. Of course, I completely agree. I usually kind of refrain from having any kind of political opinions because I try to be here as a social scientist, and I try to just bring like the evidence, and then you can make of it what you will. But obviously, there you can make the case that when our Prime Minister Mark Rutte said that the gyms should remain open because people need to be healthy, that you could also make that argument for different kind of cultural institutes. And I wouldn't only focus then on music, but on all kinds of culture, because some people have this more with visual arts or theater and such. And then if you walk into an H&M or a Zara and you see that those things are open, whereas everything that you can get there, you can also buy online, whereas the things that we want, that people who like music want, you cannot get online in the same way, I would say that's a fairly easy thing to shift, right, to say Zara and H&M, they go online, and music goes offline, and culture in general. But I mean, that also shows that it's not a perspective or an idea or a notion that's shared among the majority of society. So not only in politics, but also among the majority of people. I'm always reluctant to say that music does this for everyone, because it doesn't do this. It's a selective part of society for which it does do this. And this is a large group in society, but it's not the majority. And I think, of course, if we're talking politics, then majorities tend to matter. And then finally, music and culture just doesn't have the strong lobby that the Zaras and the H&Ms and the Ikeas of this world do have. So, but I completely agree with you, and I think initially the focus in this debate was very much about the musicians and culture producers, and you do see increasingly that people have started talking more about, but what about audiences? Because a lot of people actually need this to feel good. They don't need to go to the gym to feel good. Actually, going to the gym can make you also feel bad. Like, oh man, I'm so out of shape, I shouldn't go here. And but then you go to a concert and you forget all about that, right? And so I think over the next, I hope over the next months, we're going to see more, at least dialogue about this, trying to keep an open dialogue. And also about nightlife and clubbing, specifically for young people. I mean, clubbing in particular, and going to music concerts, there are a lot of people in society who cannot find a place for their identity. Queer people, people who are at home in closets, so to say, metaphorically, and who find their identity in these kind of places. And they lose themselves in these crowds, and that gives them a sense of identity and sense of worth. So I think that's also related to that. So not just music, but also these environments on their own. Lots of hands. You're calling quits today, so I will just continue. And and if you say the time is up, then the time is up. But I can stick around for a while if you have any question, but I see a very pointy finger there, so shall we do that as a last question?
Yes. No, I was just wondering about sort of class consumption within the pandemic. Has there been a way in which different sort of social groups consume music differently? Sort of, is there a snobbish way to consume music during the pandemic or any control over the pandemic?
So, yeah. Yeah, so this is a good question. So if we think about class, that are there different ways of consuming music or culture in general, and then is that different within this pandemic? And I think this is a good question. Femke, I think, knows more about this than I do, because her research focuses on class also in particular. But I think what I could say is that class, of course, influences how you experience any kind of culture. So Femke's research also shows that in lower class environments, when they go, for instance, to these levenslied events or piratenfeesten, then it's much more kind of a carnivalesque atmosphere of singing along with the songs and shouting and throwing your beer in the sky and these kind of things. And that can be kind of a way to emotionally out yourself in some kind of way. Whereas in more, you could say, higher educated ways, this kind of enjoyment is often more distanced, right? So snobbish enjoyment, you could say, is often without moving a lot and with intrinsically reflecting on something and thinking what this means to you intellectually. A lot of people standing still. Usually the more complex concerts get in terms of classical music, but also in terms of like math rock or these kind of genres, the more people stand still and are just like looking like this. And then at the end they say, that was amazing, right? And the idea there would be is that they that it enters very differently. The question, of course, that you ask, is that different? Well, then you could say, and again, freely theorizing here, so think about this yourself as well, that the way we consume music during COVID-19 caters better to the latter taste, so to the more snobbish intellectual sitting behind your desk, listening to music, make it, you know, make you feel better than it does for these kind of more outward physical ways of showing your joy and emotions. But that would be just a theory. Yeah. Thanks.